Here we are with GMT's Reds, a game by Ted Racier, who many know for his design for Paths of Glory, which is a card-driven game about the Western Front of World War I. But I think many people also know that Ted does a lot with World War I games in general. And this one, of course, as you can guess by the title, is about the Russian Civil War. It says so at the top here, I guess. 1918 to 1921. I picked this game up. This is one of the very, I think it is actually the very first Hex Encounter war game I ever played. And I bought this game one night. I don't really remember it, so it must have been a total, drunken order one night on the GMT P500 system. I was like, oh yeah, the Russian Civil War, you know, I studied Russian history. That's pretty interesting. I'd like to see a game on it. So I pre-ordered it and then promptly forgot about it. And then I think like a year or so later, it showed up on my doorstep and I was like, oh, okay. And since I've really never really played Hex Encounter War games, even though this one is not as complex as some of the others I've played now or more accustomed to playing or just more familiar with, I should say, man, when I first got this one out, it was a little daunting. It sat on my shelf probably for a year, maybe a year and a half or 2 years. Before I finally had the courage to sort of open the box up, really dive into the rules, and just start messing around with the counters. But, you know, I really enjoyed the game. It's not the most complex game. It's not necessarily a very faithful simulation of the Russian Civil War, but I think it covers enough of the bases to be interesting for the design of that conflict. This is just one of the most difficult things I could think of to simulate. You know, war itself is already very difficult. Combat is very difficult to approximate in a, you know, chit design, right? A hex encounter cardboard design. But when you talk about the Russian Civil War, which was such a messy affair and so chaotic and had so many different elements, right, that we're going to talk about as we look at the design here and the map. You know, anything that can even try to approximate as a whole the situation that went on and do so reasonably, I mean, I feel like that's a success. Now, you know, I think I've said before, I am not a stickler or, you know, I don't find any fault if a game does not follow historical patterns or the narrative or doesn't convey to me the period or the feel. I know that's really, that makes me sound like a heretic to some, but you know, honestly, I just played to see if I enjoy the game and if I get a feel out of it for the period, that's pretty good for me. And I can even say with some confidence this game, just despite it not being a total, you know, accurate simulation of the period, the things it does cover, the ideas it does convey through its mechanics and how you play the game from both sides, there's enough there to really say, yeah, this has definitely sourcing and ideas and how the war operated and how what the outcomes were desired, you know, and sort of what happened. So all those things put together, the fact that I enjoyed it, it's my first game, I'm going to play it again. And I haven't decided to play the long campaign game or the short one. It's difficult for me to get a ton of turns in because I'm so busy. And especially when I record that, it goes a little bit slower. But then again, I've gotten better at playing war games in general and internalizing the rules. And this one does not have a lot of crazy concepts or rules that make it difficult to grasp. Certainly if it's your first war game, yeah, there's a lot there, but it makes for a pretty good introductory war game in that respect, because it has enough of the general concepts that all war games share, such as zones of control, supply, logistics, and the combat system is fairly simplistic, although it has its own little wrinkles, but there's enough there that if you were just starting war games, this could be, a somewhat approachable one. If you had someone guide you through it, you could definitely play it solo. It's very solo friendly because it is a chip pull game, as we'll talk about. It's enough to mess with, and it's not so crazy with so many things to integrate that you'll lose track of stuff. So in that regards, it can be, I guess, considered from my point of view, a good introductory game. So maybe I lucked out by getting it. So yeah, let's stop looking at the cover there. Let's start looking at the board. So the one interesting thing about Reds is that it does cover basically the entire map of Russia in a standard, like, 24 by 32 board, right? Oh, back away lights. Ooh, try to get real bird's eye view. Yeah, I'm using lights, sorry about that. But you can kind of see it fits all on one board. So you get the entire thing here, right? So here's sort of the, I'm losing all track of my thoughts now down here. It's here the Caucasus you've got down here. You've got sort of the Urals and Siberia over there, and then over here sort of the Ukrainian territory and Poland. Okay. So it does cover the entire general area of Russia. I mean, we're not going all the way to Vladivostok, but we've got the core primary central region of production and sort of agriculture over here, where the populations were. At the cost of those, having this on one map is that each of these hexes is a scale of 65 miles per hex. So for some people that might sort of rankle because it's just, that's a fairly wide amount of distance to cover in one hex. So I could see some people saying, well, that's how can you have a combat system that actually, you know, is faithful or does anything reasonable with those kind of distances. But, you know, I think it does it okay. And that's just something you got to do if you're going to have the entire map of Russia on one, you know, one map. If I remember right, this game is also fairly cheap and affordable. I can't remember what I paid for it, but being a one mapper, that sort of just that helps out the cost as well, right? And this is not an entirely complex game either. I think I remember reading that this was originally a magazine game that GMT sort of had Ted, you know, kind of did the better treatment for. Actually, let's just do this down here. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what's up with this game. So the general thrust of it is whites versus reds, and it's a chip pool game. The basic conceit, though, is that the whites would have never won. Like Ted states that right up front in the designer notes. So it just says, you know, the whites couldn't have won essentially because they were so fractious themselves and their goal was to basically overthrow the Bolshevik government, but they each had different ideas of what they wanted to have in its place. What united them clearly was their distaste for Bolshevik rule, and that was about it. So the Reds, on the other hand, had a much more centralized, and honestly at this point they had enough control of the central region here. As you can see with the map set up, you know, they have Moscow, they have Petrograd up there. They do have sort of the heart of the production region here and some of the old cultural part of Russia. And so they have interior lines. And there's enough control there that honestly, it was going to be very difficult to knock the Bolsheviks out. You would have essentially had to have either had a coup go on in the government itself, the Red leadership, and having it fall apart. Or you would have had a military oust them with Allied intervention, essentially, which this game does have Allied chits, but they're not essentially that powerful. So the basic idea is that the whites can only win as so long as they can hold out. And holding out essentially means grabbing resource hexes throughout the board. I think we'll see a couple here, like, you know, here's one in Rostov that's got that little white border around it. That's a resource hex. There's no one here in Simbirsk. And if you grab the people's gold, that also counts as a resource hex. And we'll talk more about that because that's one of the first essential moves the white player must make is to grab the people's gold and spirit it away to Omsk in order to actually have one of these resource hexes. The reason you get those is because as the turn progresses, here's the turn track, you can see, so you can see here on the turn track we have various dates, right? So it goes over all the way from, what does it start at? August 1918 and goes all the way to March, April. 1921. So, was that 1890? Yeah, after, you know, essentially 4 years of combat, of constant civil war conflict, not necessarily combat. But then interspersed between those turns are sort of these, I forget what they call them. Let me look on the actual sequence of play. And now I can't find it. Oh, here it is. What are those called? Those are actually called strategic turns. And essentially they are just like, essentially what they sound like, they're sort of strategic updates of what's going on in the game. So you get certain reinforcements that'll come in for both sides. Strategic turn B is the big one. That's when we get a lot of the Polish forces and nationalist elements that'll come out. It's also when the map widens up. If you kind of see where we've got the forces outlined here, move this back over here, get some more light. If you see kind of the boards laid out here, there's this big gap here because initially this is where the Central Powers have occupied. If you know a little bit about the Russian Civil War history, right after the Bolsheviks took power and seized from the Provisional Government, they sort of entered into sort of negotiations with the Central Powers in which they essentially were stalling, hoping that revolution would destroy the Central Powers from within. The Central Powers got tired of all the stalling tactics and they actually took over what was essentially the Ukraine. And so the game doesn't model that by having central power units. It just says, hey, until turn B, strategic turn B, no unit can cross. And you can really barely see if it's like this little barbed wire line. No one can cross into that area at all. And it also blocks zones of control. So if you, you know, hex sides get blocked with it. Anyway, you can't move in that area, and it actually it sort of butts up all the way over here, as you can see. Right there, just Rostov doesn't count. It's in this occupied area. So initially, where this white force is, which is the armed forces of South Russia, you're going to have a very limited area of operation. And when we discuss how a supply works, you're going to understand it's incredibly limited. That's one thing about this game. You may look at the map. It's kind of a Spartan map. You know, it's something not super decorative. It is done by the venerable Mark Simonich, so it looks good. It's very functional. You can definitely tell some of the magazine game roots, though, coming out of that. Not a lot of super special features. You do have sort of streams. We got like a major river here. We have cities. Some cities are red cities. This counts in terms of control. So red cities essentially always remain in red control unless a white unit is occupying it. And it also does not give any defensive bonuses for white units when they're in there. Most of the time when you're in a city, you get a nice combat shift for being in that city, but it does not happen for whites in red cities. So again, if I pull that light out of the way, there we go. One nice thing about this map is, even as Spartan as it may be, and I don't really, you know, for me that's not a detractor. Aesthetics are a bonus, it's not necessarily a negative. The nice thing about this map being so Spartan and is that all the information you really need to play the game is on the map itself. So we have the combat table here. We sort of have how strategic movement works. These are our special chromy units that we can get. Chromy. Not crummy, just the elements of chrome. And this is where we get sort of the flavor of the Russian Civil War, right? So we have armored trains, flotillas, we've got some air power here. Tanks can come into play as well. And most of these come through the random events. Every turn when we play, we get to roll on the random events table, and that'll determine whether or not some of these units come into play. There's also partisans. They can do very limited, interesting things. So yeah, that's sort of a, they all have their own kind of rules of where to be placed and movement, but that is sort of the, you know, especially the armored trains thing, that is definitely over there. The armored trains, you know, that's the signature element of the Russian Civil War, so of course they're here in spades. There's also some limited naval stuff. Essentially, these units, as we talk about combat, it's pretty limited. There's not a lot of naval rules going on. It's mainly a land game, as the Russian Civil War generally was. Over here, we sort of have the terrain effects chart. So everything you need to know about the terrain is there. Rail lines, the Krug hexes. This has to do with Cossacks. Cossacks actually is a big prominent force in this game, of course, for the whites. And the rivers, the Volga has some interesting rules there. And then of course, like desert, you can't even move in desert. So there's like a whole part of this map you just don't even get to go into. So, you know, there's that. What else is there on the map? Oh yeah, we also have over here the Red Army High Command. As we get leaders through random events, this is what drives the Red Army's ability to get more chits in the cup. We'll discuss that in a second as we talk about what chits do and how we get those moving. And here's sort of the allied chits. And there's also a logistics chit, which we'll talk about in a second. The main thing about this game in terms of how it operates, and let's take a break here and we'll talk about supply. So as you'll notice, the rail lines are big in this game, and that's because in this war, as in I think a lot of I can't really think of any other examples, maybe like the American Civil War, you really had to stay close to either big time rivers or rail lines, because these were your arteries of supply and communications. This game is no different. The supply rules are incredibly strict in this regard. So you have sort of these hexes here that have that symbol to designate what army they supply. This one, it's hard to tell. It's a tealish color. That supplies the armed forces of South Russia. That's one of their supply points. To be considered in supply, when you draw the logistics chit, both sides check for supply. To be considered in supply, you have to be either on a river or rail line that connects back to a supply point, or you have to be one hex away from that. So what that means is, let's take this Cossack for example. If you're here, you're out of supply because you are now more than one hex away from the rail line or a river. If you're here, that's considered in supply so long as you can trace it back and not have an enemy zone of control interrupt that trace back to your supply point. Okay. If you are found out of supply, you become disrupted. And in this game, that's the step loss. It doesn't say step loss, it just says disrupted. Disruption is a combat result that can also be done through being out of supply. If you are found out of supply and you're disrupted already, then you're off the map, you're done. Units can come back if, as long as they don't have a dot on them. And that means, like the Cossacks here, they can come back. So even if these guys get eliminated, I believe they get to come back on the next strategic turn. Maybe not. I'll look that up to be certain. But many white units, to just demonstrate sort of the brutalness of the white cause itself, you see these little dots in the corner. If these units are ever eliminated through attrition or military results, they never come back. They're just eliminated from the game permanently. And so that's sort of, as you'll find in the game, the white units tend to be able to stack. You can stack more units in a hex with white units than the red army can necessarily. And that definitely reflects the fact that many of the white forces had, you know, probably better military commanders initially. I mean, you have to remember that the red army was literally being formed from scratch and being done during this period. So the leadership had to develop, and maybe the top levels, like we say with Trotsky, maybe had a good idea of what was going on, but really it's your battlefield commanders and whatnot that make it actually able to carry out military campaigns. So the white forces kind of get that advantage in this game in the fact that many of their units can actually just have a better ability to stack. And so I guess it's a good time to talk about what units mean of the counters themselves. So let's take a look at this Cossack unit. You'll see this number here is the stacking number. In this game, the limit is 6 in a stack. As you can see here with Red Army units, let's use this guy over here, they have 4. So that means that until you get certain, the Red Army has the ability to overstack, but that's only if you get a leader. We'll talk about that in a second. But that means initially is that the Red Army guys can't stack. So one army occupies one hex. But white units can stack. So we see here that the Cossacks cost 2. That's 2, 4. Got these guys are 1 each. And what that means is when you do combat, generally the more units you bring into combat, the potential for like multiplying your power increases, and I'll discuss that in a second. But that's what the stacking unit means. So white forces, this sort of demonstrates their like better command capability and the fact that they can stack more units in a hex. But many of the forces are, you know, as I said, have a dot, so they're brittle. So if they get eliminated, they're gone. Whereas red army units, if they get eliminated, they just keep coming back out. And so the Red Army will pretty much never ever exhaust itself of troops, and it pretty much will always be able to replace even horrendous losses. But if it is taking horrendous losses, that means it is having exposed areas, it's exposed to attack, it's going to be hard-pressed to repulse any kind of white effort, and as long as the whites can stay in the game, they can keep allied support in. That means they can get access to better units, they rally better. There's lots of other effects for having the allies in the game for the whites. So the whites really want to hold out and just keep the reds at bay, and that really does involve striking where they're not. Hit them where they ain't, right? But that's, we'll talk about more about the strategy later. Other numbers include attack, defense, movement. You'll notice some of these units have pluses, some of them have negatives. Like if we take this unit and flip him over, he has negative values over there. Okay. That's interesting when I first got this war game, and it's something I hadn't really seen in other war games, but it factors in the way the combat system works and the fact that you can have units have very poor values, but if you can get a couple of them together, then they can sort of multiply their effects despite their poor quality, because this really is a war about not even necessarily quality troops. Both sides had very poor quality troops. This is really just about morale and who could lead the day with initiative. This was the kind of battle this was. Or the kind of war the Civil War was, the Russian Civil War. So what that means is when you do an attack, let's go ahead and just discuss attack, because there's really not a lot of difference. You see here, these are cavalry units there, because they're Cossacks. We have infantry. That's pretty much the only 2 units we have in this game. You do have armored trains and flotillas and airplanes, but in terms of unit diversity, this was a very much basic infantry war. Like, very few cavalry units exist. The Red Army does get their Konarmia, the sort of the horse army, comes in later. Proletarians to horse. But you know, it's mainly an infantry battle, so there's not a lot of difference between cavalry and infantry units in terms of them being an inherent unit qualities, right? So, like in some games, cavalry units can infiltrate or do crazy things, right? The infantry can't, or infantry can slog through terrain better rates, or that doesn't apply here. They're just basically just one-up units. So let's talk, let's do a little discussion of zones of control and attack. So every unit in this game projects a standard, you know, zone of control all the way around it, unless they have a special unit that has like a Z on it. I think that means they ignore zones of control when they move. So I think everything projects a zone of control And what that means is that zones of control are sticky, I believe is the term we want to use, which means if you enter it, you stop. So let's take an example here. Let's say we have Markov, and Markov moves over to the 11th Army and goes right there. Markov has to stop now because he's entered the zone of control. You cannot move from one zone of control to another zone of control. Nothing negates it for in purposes of movement. So Markov can't now, in a subsequent move, go here or here because they cannot move into another adjacent zone of control. Instead, what this unit would have to do is go, let's say, up here and then here in order to move from one zone to another. You have to sort of kind of wheel around it. That makes for interesting movements, and especially when you consider supply, because you have to be so close to the rail lines that it can be difficult to wheel your units around and not get stuck in other zones of control, because, you know, you can just put a couple units out and boom, you've projected quite a wide area of zone of control. When you attack, you can, we have all these guys here. Let's say this attack happens, because this will probably happen when we start the game up. We got three units here from the white, the AFSR forces are going to attack the 11th Army here. Combat is pretty simple. What you do is you take your units and you calculate, take all your units and you add up the values first. So we have plus three here, or he has plus two for defense, and you do attack to defense. So these guys have plus two, plus two, plus two. So we have 6-2. Ooh, hold on one second. All right, yeah, I just wanted to double check I had that right, and only because it's just been a little bit since I played, and I did read the rules, but you always want to make sure when you're talking about how something basic like combat works, you get that part right at least. So when we do this combat, the first thing we do is we calculate the odds, and the way we do that is I did talk about these values, hold off on that a second. So let's calculate the odds first. So the stacking value I pointed to is also the odds calculator. So this is a 4 value, and these guys together are 3. So this is a 3-4 attack, and you always round off in the defender's favor. So 3-4 is not 1-1 odds, it becomes 1-2 odds. So that's the very first thing you do, you sit there and calculate the odds. Pretty easy stuff so far. So we got 1-2. Now you calculate sort of the attack and defense factors, and we see here that we have 2, 4, 6 here, and this guy has a plus 2. So when you calculate the difference, you end up getting a plus 4 result. Now the reason we do that is because we're going to, hold on a second. So we calculated all that. Silly me, I should have just read it completely, and then I was like, wait, I got this. I can totally remember all this. Okay. Do. Ah, that's what it is. Okay. So we're going to determine the combat odds first, as we just did, and it's 1-2 odds. And then what we're going to do is each player is going to roll the die, and this is where the stacking kind of works in. So here's where that interesting wrinkle comes from. Each player is going to roll one die, and they're going to multiply the die roll by the number of participating units, and then we're going to add or subtract all the modifiers to determine the combat value strength here. And what that basically means is that in this case, we have these two units here, we got the red and white. So we determine it's 1-2 odds. So we're gonna roll here. All right. So, this were the results. 1-2 odds, the white rolls a 5 and the red rolled 4. Now white multiplies this result by the number of units it brought into battle. So in this case, it brought 3 units into battle times 5, that's 15. It then adds in all of its modifiers here. So we knew that was what, 2, 4, 6. So we get 15 plus 6 is 21. The red takes his values and gets 4 times 1, because he only had one unit participating in the attack. So that's 4. Then he adds in his defensive value, and that's 6. So 21 minus 6 becomes 15, a positive 15. So then what you do is you take that number and you come over to the combat odds table. So we look up and we say, okay, it's a 1-2 attack, but it was plus 15 result. Okay, so what does this mean? It has an A, D, R. If it's a little a, that means one of the attackers suffers a disruption result. If it's a big letter, like a big D here, it means all the defenders suffer a disruption result, and the R means that they also must retreat. So if we come back over here, you can see that we'll have to take one of these units and pick one. We can choose whichever one we like. And they're all sort of the same, so we'll say, oh, no, Kornilov, he got disrupted. And so the 11th Army, it was disrupted, and it also must retreat 2 hexes. You can retreat in any direction you like, as long as you don't end up in an enemy zone of control. And if you have to pass through an enemy zone of control, you suffer another disruption result. So, you know, if I went here, I could, but I would just die, right? And I couldn't do that. I could go here and here if I wanted, or I can go here and here, right? And get away. And that's essentially combat. So you can see here that the interesting part of combat is that it really is variable on how many units you can bring in. And the whites are always able to get more units generally into a battle, but they're much more brittle. As you can see here, I took a step loss. Honestly, I would never make a 1-2 attack. I would try to get at least a 1-1, because then, even then you're still suffering. You're suffering some attrition. And in this game, the whites, you know, they can take some lumps, but they can't take a lot, right? Because then if I lose this guy, then he's gone forever. Whereas this, if the 11th Army is eliminated, it'll just come back the next turn it can. So that's why combat kind of favors the whites, but even really big battles can be crazy swings, right? Because if I had this battle, for example, and rolled a 1, and the red rolls a 6, right? So if we go back and look at this again, just to demonstrate sort of how it can be really swingy. Well, now we just have 1 times 3 units. Oops, I'm sorry. Well, now we just have 1 times 3 units here, so that just becomes 3 plus 6, so that becomes a 9. Right, so let's just erase all these numbers, right? It was 1-2 attack, but now it's 9 minus 6, 7, 8. Because it's just 6 times 1 unit, we add in his 2 defensive value, we get 8. All of a sudden, that's just a plus 1 result. And if we look at a plus 1 result on the 1-2 combat table, the attacker takes a disruption, and the defender would do nothing. So even though I brought in more forces, even though I have sort of the greater organizational capacity, which I believe is what that's sort of modeling, I still lost the battle because of this rule, even though I brought in 3 times the forces, right, or I should be able to get that modifier. So even big battles, if you get bad rules, can be very, very swingy. Some other things to think about. Cossack units are noted with their sort of yellow movement values, and they have a home hex, the Krug hex. They can only operate in an 8-hex sort of sphere around that area, right? An 8-hex radius. They can't attack outside of that, they can only attack within that, and they can't go beyond that sort of barrier. So they're sort of like regional assistants and helpers, but they can't go, they can only go to a certain extent, and you can see where their place is very strategic. What else is another thing? This is sort of when I just discussed combat, this is why getting little chrome units or special bonuses through the random events, such as flotilla units that must stay on rivers, or even armored units, which must stay on rail lines, of course. You can even get a plane. When you start battles, these count as units. So let's say this force here, you know, had a tank this time, right? And they come up here. Well, you actually get to choose if you're gonna allocate these units, you know, but I'm gonna say I am. Well, now I have 4 units here instead of just the 3, right? And the odds have moved up because he counts as 1 manpower. So now it's a 1-to-1 attack. And I have 4 units. You can only have 1 of, I believe, each special type of unit there, so I could have a tank, an airplane, and like a flotilla, but I couldn't have 2 flotillas, and I couldn't have 2 tanks or something. So these units are how you start multiplying the value of your stacks there. I mentioned that you can only stack up to 6 points, right? And so as we said, notice here, the armies usually are 4. If through a random event we are able to get a red leader in play, such as Fatsatsis, then there's a process by which we sort of randomly get to be randomly assigned over here to one of the fronts. We roll a die, and whatever number comes up is the front that leader gets assigned to. And if we had, let's say, Fatsatsis, and he was in the southern front, right? Like we rolled, got that event, he goes in the southern front. Well, one of the bonuses is I get to have this now every turn for free. Normally, the red player has to pick 2 fronts, and he gets the field staff chit, and also anything he has a leader in. So as you get leaders, you get more chits for free. The bonus, though, is you can see Vatsasis has a 1 value for his chit. That means that in 1 hex in the south, as you can see, the south front here sort of stretches from, oops, all the way over here. It's kind of got this weird line. You get used to seeing these fronts, and I'll do a bird's eye view, but you see there's south front. That means in 1 hex in the south front, he can have a stacking value of up to 9. So I could actually stack two armies, and later when I get something like, where are the Latvian rifles? They're actually here. They're like the special Bolshevik unit, yeah. So they have a value of one. So when you get that stacking ability, you can suddenly have two armies and the Latvian rifles, and that's a force. And the white player will be hard-pressed to actually do anything about that. And that's how the red player can get out of stacking units, and that's how we get more chits. Let's see, you roll for initiative, and that's basically every turn you get to roll, and whoever wins the die roll gets initiative for that turn, and they get to select one of their fronts to activate first. After that, you just keep drawing chits until you get to the end, and that's the end of that turn. Logistics is just a chit that comes up. When it does, we check for supply for both sides. I think I discussed that earlier. But and there is some interesting rule that you cannot put a unit into what would be out of supply on a move. Like, a move cannot place it out of supply. It's one of those weird movement rules here. And there's some way it makes sense. Like, I wouldn't be able to intentionally move it out of supply, but once it's out of supply, then I can move it anywhere I want. It's a very weird little loopy rule, but you'll see when the logistics chit gets pulled that it'll come up through various points in the turn, and that will impact sort of how much you want to press your luck or how much luck you can, you know, press once you know the logistics chit's already been drawn. There's also these done markers, because sometimes a red army unit will move from one front to another. Let's say this one up here that is located in the, what is that, the east front. If for some reason he came down here to do something, he can't be activated again if the east front gets drawn. You know, units only can be activated once per turn. So if your unit crosses into another front, then you're done using it, then you put a done marker on it just so you realize, oh yeah, next turn you can take this off and he's considered in the south front, right? But for the origin purposes, at the start of a turn, that unit was considered in the east front. So the done markers mark that. That's not such a big deal for the whites, because the whites rarely, like here are the Siberian whites, you know, they're up here, here's the AFSR. They rarely meet. They often have different drives and objectives. As you'll see, it's much more natural for the Siberians to kind of go this way. It's much more natural for the AFSR to kind of curve that way and come up. They can't stack with each other. The whites can only stack with allied units, which look like this. And this little tan guys, this is allied intervention forces. Those units are considered white. They do have a chit that you draw right here, the AIF chit. But you have to actually roll an event on the random events table that will let you attack with them. You can move with them, and the other big part of that force is up here, right? The old Romansk Archangel force that was actually Japanese and American troops that had come up and sort of made their presence known when they were afraid the Bolsheviks were reneging on their deal to keep attacking the Germans. So you get to move those guys, but they don't get to really attack. Oh, look, I made a mess here. They don't get to attack unless you roll that event on the random events table, which, let's go ahead and pull that out. Yeah, here it is. So you can see there the number 6, the AIF offensive. Any or all AIF units may attack this turn when the chit is played. And there's other things, like you get the Typhus, Disorder 1 red infantry or cavalry unit of your choice. You get to have a tanks, you get invasion markers, some political intrigue or aircraft. The Reds also have their own chart. Partisans, a lot of the same stuff, but they also get like Red Terror, which converts a city over to being a red city, which is very awful for the whites, makes it much more difficult to hold. Also has a rally chart here. Replacements, the red city summary. See, this is why it's so bad. Combat shifts. If you're in a city, you get a shift in your favor, unless it's a red city and you're a white unit, in which case you don't. That's why red cities are so bleh and hard to hold. If you are in a river hex and a unit attacks you and it's not on that river hex, it suffers, you get a defensive shift in your favor. So like, for example, here in Tsaritsyn, or let's just use this example. Let's say this Red Army unit here, right? This is the 9th Army. Yeah. So let's say the 9th Army is being attacked by the Cossacks here. If they were attacking like from there, he would get a defensive bonus because he's on a river. But if they attack from the river, like from a river hex side, he doesn't. And that's covered over here on the terrain effects chart. And so he gets this one L with the star because it has sort of like a... No attack long, it's the same river, yeah. And also can be used for supply. So when you trace supply, you're allowed to trace it over rail lines and rivers, and you can use a combination of them, but only once. Like, you can't do a rail-river-rail combination. You can do a rail-river combination or river-rail, but you can't, like, jump twice, right? That's why rivers and railroads in this game are so essential, and that's sort of why they become the avenues of movement for many of the forces here. Like, so you can see here, we'll get close on the Siberian situation here. You know, there's lots of rail lines here, but control, like, key cities such as here in Simbirsk, that's obviously a nice little junction. You want to grab control of that if you can, because it gives you access to all these lines. Just like up here in Ufa is the same way, right? Holding Ufa gives you access to those two lines. I wonder if we come up here where these checks are, you barely see. This little junction here becomes important. So rail junctions are important, and that's also just your avenues of advance, because you can't deviate more than a hex from them. So, yeah. At first, when I played this game, I found that kind of restrictive, but it also just makes a lot more sense when you think about the period and the kind of warfare, because, you know, this is the Russian Civil War. These groups are motley crews of volunteers or just deserters that have come from the other side. And it's largely in a country that's been torn apart by war for already 4 years, and now it's going to go through about another 4 years of just absolute gut-wrenching warfare. And this is even more brutal because it's the Civil War. So it's understandable that you'd have to stick to rail lines, that you couldn't just sort of willy-nilly your way across the vast plains of Russia, the steppe, or sort of the more forbidding Ural Mountains and whatnot, because, quite frankly, the supply situation was tenuous at best. I mean, the Whites only thrived because of the very minimal supplies given to them by the Allies, which is why it's important to keep the Allies in the game. And I think I talked about this before, but just do a quick recap. When you get to strategic turns, it'll say something like withdraw if less than four. That means if you hold three or less resource hexes, including the gold, then you have to check for withdrawal. Or you don't check for withdrawal, it just starts happening. And there's two phases, minor withdrawal and major withdrawal. And minor just gives you like less ability to rally, and then major takes away all your good toys like airplanes and river flotillas and whatnot. And you also don't get to replace units. It becomes basically almost impossible for the Whites to maintain their thrust without Allied support. So this is sort of the built-in clock mechanism that makes the Whites not just hold out, but sort of want to aggressively push out. The Reds win if they can either seize every city on the map and put a control marker in it, which includes even these cities over here, which is the most difficult part, is to go over here and take these. Or they have to have control of, they have to have control of key resource hexes, and then also defeat Poland. And there's a way to trigger the Polish war. Entry of the Poles come in. After turn B, you set up Poland, and there are certain conditions that govern their entry into the war. One of the big ones is if the Reds don't maintain an armed presence around Poland, then they will just kind of come in and sort of seize the advantage. Or if you bring any units into Poland, then Poland, of course, will start fighting. Yeah, here we go. The Red wins if they control every city on the map outside of Poland and the Baltic Republics, or if they control every resource city on the map and have conquered Poland. So there's two ways to win as a Red player. The Polish one is considered the alternative history variant. If you do that, you've considered to have changed history. If you just take every city inside of Russia, and the Baltic Republics up here, and sort of the Ukraine, especially over here too, then that's considered the historic win, because that's what the Reds eventually did. They seized control of the central area, and then slowly but surely spread out. At first, they tackled the Siberians, and then they came south and dealt with the forces of Denikin and later Wrangel. And that's pretty much the game right there. It's not too crazy. It uses a very simplistic combat system. It's just a 2d6s. You know, the tricky part, of course, is the stacking and the rolling and sort of gambling if your big stack's going to make it or not. And I will say, I haven't played this game before, that the Whites it's very brittle. You cannot afford to lose very many White forces, because if you do so, the game's pretty much over. Like, you can't get too risky here. You gotta know when to strike, you gotta know when to hold and pull back, you gotta know when it's just better to draw the enemy out and then cut them off in a counterattack. But you also have to know when to press it and when to really put the hurt on them, because the big focus here is to draw enough support from one area that the other area can make advances and so forth. I had one game where I was almost able to take Moscow through a desperate drive by the AFSR. I'd gotten two airplanes. It was some ridiculous luck on the random events table. And I was able to make a pretty good drive here. But even then, I just couldn't quite break the Reds. It just wasn't able to do it. One thing I should mention, of course, the big advantage the Reds have is the Red Train Unit, which is not in focus. Here we go. The Red Train Unit. This is, of course, representing Trotsky and his famous Red Train that had a telegraph and on it, a printing press. It was the modern mobile communications platform of its time. Any Red Army unit next to the Red Train during the rally phase of the logistics automatically becomes rallied. You don't have to roll to see if it rallies, it just automatically rallies. And that's a huge advantage because essentially you can take, when units come back, they come in depleted when they get returned to the map. So you can put a bunch of depleted units around the Red Train and boom, you know, keeps them going or can keep an offensive going. It's really quite incredible, the power of the Red Train. And if you eliminate it by attacking it, it just goes away for a turn, and then it comes back. So you can't even get rid of it. Difficult for the whites to deal with. So anyway, yeah, that's Reds. I think I pretty much covered everything. Oh, there's garrison units as well. Garrison units are kind of important because they're not very good. Like they're not offensive, right? You can't really attack with them. What they do is they sort of maintain your presence in the cities and hold down your supply lines. And you have to attack them to get rid of them. So the enemy must use some forces, which can sometimes mean they suffer attrition. The downside is you only have a limited amount of them, so you want to use them judiciously. You can pick them up during, let me see. When can you pick up the markers? I think it's during like strategic movement, or maybe it's during something else. But at one point during the game, when we start playing the game, I do a more detailed sequence of play explanation. There is a point at which you can decide to pick them up off the map, and then you can place them in cities as you move through them and establish control. And really, using those is very key. For the whites, it's incredibly key, because as you spread out further and further away from sort of your central home base, protecting the lines back to your supply source is going to be really dependent on putting these garrison units in key spots, right, and holding key junctions. Because it is going to slow down the enemy from taking it. It's going to give you time to react. And it allows your units to advance forward while keeping your rear lines, you know, somewhat secure. So yeah, garrisons are kind of big. And there are partisans. And they actually have some special movements and rules. But they come out through random events. And they're actually terrible at combat. They can't participate in combat with other units or other partisans. Their main objective in life is to be a pain in the ass in the rear guard of your enemy. You can cut off supply with them, they can take unoccupied cities and hold them, they can just basically cut rail lines. I mean, that's what they do. They draw forces away, they're distractions, and they can potentially, if you time it well with their movement and drawing up logistics chits, you can either eliminate weakened forces that you've brought down or weaken a strong position, a strong point, by having them slip in behind, cut supply off, and then have logistics get pulled. But they come in through random events, so you have to see if you get them or not. Not always guaranteed. Okay, I think that is pretty much every unit here I've discussed. So that's Reds. It's a pretty interesting game. We're going to get started. I think, honestly, I'll play probably the short game. Short game, just when you play to strategic turn E, and the goal of the Reds is to prompt a major withdrawal by then. If they don't, the whites win. And that's actually the tournament scenario, and it's actually very playable. Because you start playing this long game, then it's really just about holding on as the whites, and then as the reds trying to take every city. It can be done, but a lot of the excitement dies down after this turn, because you do make pretty big pushes with the whites here. Anyway, so that's GMT's Reds. And when we come back next time, we'll start it off with movement from the AFSR, and also the Siberians.